हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम डॉक्टर हरीन रामसियारी फ्रॉम किरोड़ीमल कॉलेज, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक ऑन मॉड्यूल पॉपुलेशन इंट्रैक्शन इवोल्यूशन प्रोसेस एंड थ्योरीज ऑफ पैरासाइटिज्म, एमेंसलिज्म, म्यूचुअलिज्म अंडर पेपर प्रिंसिपल ऑफ इकोलॉजी लर्निंग आउटकम्स। आफ्टर स्टडिंग दिस मॉड्यूल यू शैल बी एबल टू डिस्क्राइब्स parasitism and evolution and process of parasitism, understand the basic theory of parasitism, illustrate the emmensalism association and its types, understand the process and evolution of mutualism, define the evolutionary relationship. Introduction. Single species population involve species of similar type interacting and interbreeding within their own population. These species not only interacts with their own types but with other species from different population also. These interactions or associations can negatively or positively affect the growth and development of the population. Rarely the type of interaction is neutral, where two interacting species do not affect the population growth. This type of interaction is designated as zero-zero effect in a two-species system. Positive interactions are those where either both or only one interacting population is benefited. When both the association population are benefited, the type of interaction is called mutualism and designated as positive-positive. However, when only one type of population is benefited, forming a one-sided relationship where the interaction is neither harmed nor benefited, this type of interaction is called commensalism and designated as positive zero. On the other hand, the other type of one-sided relationship is called as emmensalism, where one population is neither harmed nor benefited, but the other population is negatively affected. This type of interaction is designated as negative zero types. Emmensalism is a nebulous relationship which involves chemical interactions such as allopathy affect in plant and antibiosis. Other type of interactions where one population is positively affect at the expense of another population is called as predation. We can see in figure number first. It's designated as positive negative predation is possible in forms of herbivory, cannibalism, parasitism and parasitoidism. Finally, the type of interaction where both the interacting population are been negatively affected are called as competition, which can be intra or interspecific competition and designated as negative negative. The evolution process and theories of some of these interactions are briefly discussed in this chapter. This figure represents different type of interactions. Mutualism, both species A and B benefit from the association. Commensalism, one species benefits while the other species is not itself affected. Emmensalism, one species is harmed while the other species is not itself affected. Exploitation, one species benefits at the expense of other species. Antibiosis, one species A produce a compound that inhibit the other species B. Species A is unaffected or may benefit. Competition, both species are harmed from the association. This table represents species interaction. Symbiosis, close living relationship. Mutualism, both species benefit, neither are harmed. Lichen is a combination of a fungus, absorbs minerals and water, and an alga, photosynthesis. Rhizobium, nitrogen fixing bacteria in root noodles of legumes, which provide carbohydrates and space to live. Commensalism, one or both species benefit but neither are harmed. The remora fish attaches itself to a shark, hitches a ride, and scavenges when the shark makes a kill. Exploitation parasitism, one species lives in or on and feeds off another host, fleas living on a dog, tapeworm living in a mammal's gut. Emensalism, one organism is inhibited, the other is unaffected. Shade from trees allows only light-tolerant plants to grow. Antibiosis, one species is unaffected or benefits, the other is harmed by a poison or toxin from the first. Rhubarb producing oxalic acid, which prevents other organisms from growing. Penicillium molds, blue-green powdery, producing penicillin, which inhibits the growth of bacteria. Parasitism. Parasitism is a type of predation in which an organism called as parasite acts as predator, lives on or inside the host organism prey. It may not kill the host organism directly, but the host organism may die due to the negative effects of parasitism. A parasite receives nourishment and or shelter from the host. It is a typical of non-mutualistic and negative relationship between parasite and host organism. The association can be temporary or permanent, resulting into a complex interaction. The parasites are called endoparasite that lives inside the body of host, such as Schistosoma monsoni, whereas those parasites that superficially attach themselves to the outer surface of host body are called as ectoparasites, such as head lice. Those parasites which are intermediate to both endo and ectoparasite are called mesoparasites, such as copepods. We can see in figure number 2. This figure represents A. Ectoparasite head lice, B. Endoparasite Schistosoma monsoni, C. Mesoparasite copepods. The parasites are classified into two types, microparasite and macroparasite, based on the size of parasites. Microparasites are small-sized, rapidly multiplying with short generation time parasites, which are capable of including immune response in host body, although the infection persists for short duration only. These parasites can travel between host by direct transmission or via vector and intermediate host. Bacteria and viruses are good example of microparasites. On the contrary, macroparasites are relatively large in size and have longer generation time. They allow short duration of immune response and the infection persists for long time. Fungi, lice, mites, parasitic worms, etc. are the example of macroparasites. We can see in figure number 3. This figure represents microparasites, Ebola virus, B. Macroparasites, lice. Based on the dependence of parasites on host, parasites are classified into two forms, permanent, full-time or facultative parasites, that are those parasites which are not necessarily live the parasitic life but under certain circumstances are capable of adapting to parasite-host relationship. Obligatory parasites are part-time or temporary parasites which completely or partially depended on the host organisms to complete their life cycles.
Evolution and process of parasitism. The parasites are extremely diverse in nature. The behavior of parasites differ in the closely related parasites also, causing different pathogenies, infecting distinct host species or infecting different tissues. For intense or typically harmless bacteria, Escherichia coli that inhabitant the human intestine can cause different diseases in different forms, such as urinary tract infection, UTI, diarrhea, kidney bleeding, intestinal bleeding, meningitis, and other disorders. Evolution is the underlying cause of occurrence of these immense diversity in parasites. It is a broadly appreciated that parasites, due to their characteristic high population density and short generation time, are more prone to switch evolution. Moreover, the evolution is far more immediate in parasites in comparison to their hosts. About half a century ago, the evolution of a drug resistance in bacteria is the first observation of drug resistance that triggered the series of attempts to understand the cause and relevance of parasite evolution to diseases. However, the original research has achieved its fertile ground base on the application of evolutionary theory to parasites. In the recent year, the parasitology and evolutionary biology have undergone rapid advances, disabling to observe to keeping shoulder to shoulder of both. There is no obvious answer to the question of when and where these parasites are arises from. All agree to the assumption that parasites have evolved from free living ancestors. The origin of parasitism, especially endoparasites, are postulated as accidental introduction of free living forms into the hosts. The host provide new environment conditions to the living, free living forms, and subcutaneous mutations in these forms under the selection pressure resulted into the selection of only those mutants which have more profitable mutations that are necessary to sustain them in the new environment. This exemplified the common concept of survival of the fittest. To support this concept, tapeworms are good examples that have efficiently adapted to parasitism. Successive occurrence of mutant forms among tapeworms lead to the establishment of tapeworms species with degenerated digestive system. These mutants form are well adapted and successful survivors that can absorb food from the new environment that consists of matrix of partially or completely digested nutrients. Thus, degenerated alimentary canal is a more efficient and advanced condition for these organisms. Furthermore, under these circumstances, the digestive system's modes of locomotion, enzymatic system, and sensation of tapeworm become adapted to parasitism. Other group of parasites have also adapted similar modifications. Pre-adaptation. The concept of pre-adaptation is important to understand the evolution of parasites from their progenitors' free living forms. Pre-adaptation does not imply that the organisms have pre-densited potential of becoming parasites. It merely means that organisms in its free living forms have distinct unmanifested potential to live parasitic life in addition to its natural adaptive characteristics, but never manifest these potentials parasitic in their free forms. However, under modified environment conditions, when these free living forms accidentally invade the host body, these organisms utilize their internal but prior and unmanifested potential to adapt in its new environment. These pre-adaptations can be both structural and physiologic adaptations. Examples could be seen in free living forms of nematodes found in decaying organic materials, which are associated with insects, beetles, etc. as intestinal parasites. These nematodes were free living creatures before they were accidentally ingested by the insects, beetles. In the gut environment, these nematodes survived, attributing to its prior unmanifested internal potential of surviving in low oxygen containing environment. Theories of parasitism. There are three generalizations that are suggested to be responsible for the evolution of parasitism and parasites based on the results of theoretical speculations. These generalizations are broad concepts with numerous exceptions. Number first, Fahrenholz hypothesis. The present-day hosts have common ancestors that are parasitized by the common progenitors of modern parasites. Thus, these hypotheses can be employed to seek clues about the degree of relationship between parentages of modern host to modern parasite. Parasites of wild animals are the best supporting evidence for the findings of these hypotheses. Although exceptions are there, such as close relationship between humans and domestic animals. Second, Sagittet's hypothesis. This hypothesis states that the more evolutionary specialized the parasites, the more specialized the host group. On the other hand, the parasites are less specialized if the host group are primitive in nature. Thus, this hypothesis seeks clues about the degree of specialization of parasite group to the phylogenetic location of the host group. Third, Eckler's hypothesis. This hypothesis serves as a clue to measure the degree of relationship between parasitic diversity and host diversity. It states that the greater diversity of parasites can be harbored by the host belonging to large taxonomic group in comparison to the host belonging to limited taxonomic group. Amensalism type 0 negative. Amensalism is a symbiotic relationship between two interacting species in which one organism restricts the growth of other individual without being affected. It is a biological association of negative and zero type. We can see in figure number 4. The common process of growth inhibition is the secretion of a special chemical compound by one living organism as a part of its normal metabolic process that acts detrimental to other. This figure represents the graphical representation depicting the amensalism relationship between species A and B. Species A's presence is detrimental to species B, exhibiting amensalism. Association between these species where the non-interacting species C is not affected by other two species. Red line represent species A affect B. Green line represent affected species B. Blue line represent non-interacting species C. Penicillium, a bread mold, is the best example of amensalism that produces bacteria-killing chemical compound called penicillin antibiotics. The biological relationship is not necessarily a symbiotic type but may represent a non-intimate biological interaction between two species such as elephants, cattle, etc. Trampling the green grass while searching for food or water resources. The cattle or elephant is unaffected but the grass is damaged. We can see in figure number 5. Although this type of interaction is listed as zero negative types but in a symbiotic emmensalism relationship, the interaction is listed as positive-negative type. As the first species which is secreting the chemical and inhibiting the other species is able to restrict competition for resources. Thus, it gains its survival. This figure represents elephant stepping on flower field. In plants, it's a site-specific association where one species is restricted while the other unaffected. In plants, Jagulanus nigra, the black walnut tree, is a good example for emmensalism. We can see in figure number 6, the neighboring plants of black walnut tree are killed by chemical called zuglone secrete from the roots. Deserts, chaparral, and many other related types of biomes have plants that depend on emmensalism type of association for their survival. This type of relationship in which biomes reduce the competition among organisms for low level of nutrients in the water. Gum tree roots also secretes chemical compounds and so emmensalism. Another common example is shading out the small plants under tall trees competition for light. The trees, although not directly by secreting any toxic chemical, but indirectly by restricting the amount of available sunlight at the ground level, prevent the adequate supply of light to the shade plants. Thus, the forest ground covers have only shade tolerant plants that require less light for survival. This figure represents an example of emmensalism, black walnut tree.
Allopathy. It's a form of interference competition among plants. One plant species produces and secretes chemical substances that prevent the growth of other plant species. These chemical substances can be simple organic compounds or acids or bases in nature that reduce the competition for space, light, and nutrients. In natural communities, many of the produced secondary chemical substances remains harmless, but few of them influence the structure of the community with their impactful negative effects. For instance, in the world, the most widely distributed vascular plant called Pteridium aquilinum release phytotoxins that gets concentrated in the soil upper surface. We can see in figure number 7. These accumulate plant toxin inhibit the growth of seedling in many plants such as conifers by killing their germinating seeds. These allopathic effects dominate large areas of ground on accumulation of dead fronds in heavy smothering over winters. This figure represents an example of allopathy, bracken fern. The direct inhibition in the growth of organisms such as herbivores, soil organisms, and other plants is carried out by the secretion of toxic chemical compounds. This is known as allopathy. Many plants secrete toxic chemicals that are harmful to animals, such as algae blooms with red, blue, and green algae release metabolites toxic to fish. It's an example of a specific type of emmensalism called antibiosis. Antibiosis is not specific to plants but simply indicate the production of toxic metabolites that are harmful for other organisms, such as antibiotics. Penicillin released by Penicillium mold inhibit the growth of bacteria. We can see in figure number 8, allopathy can be defined in various ways. Some suggested that it is only associated with the release of chemicals from plants to compete for secretions,
sources while others say that some plants use it as a defense mechanism. Some ecologists also consider allopathy and antibiosis as positive zero type of effect.
Mutualism and evolution. When the selection pressure favors the two interacting species, the relationship is called mutualism. It's a reciprocal association between two different species that positively affect both the interacting species. For example, mutualism between flowering plants and their pollinators such as yucca moth and yucca plant and male euglycine on orchids, we can see in figure number 9. In this mutual association, both species increases their growth, survival and fitness. Mutualism can be facultative or obligatory, non-symbiotic or symbiotic. For more detail, please read module from Biology of Parasitism, module number 1. This figure represents pollinators sharing a mutualistic relationship with the flowers yucca moth, yucca plant. B. Male euglycine on orchids.
Origin of evolution. Ecologists postulated that commensal relationships, parasite-host relationship, or predator-prey interactions lead to the evolution of mutualism. In the beginning, one of the interacting partners enhances the stability of available resource levels for the other partners. In the time, the benefit gained in form of energy are ensured to the other partner, and probably its activities contribute to the fitness of first partner. For instance, assume that the host plant manifests the host parasitic relationship for its benefit. However, it was tolerance for parasitic infections, indicating that the host deliberately allowed the parasite to infect itself. In time, the interacting organisms exploit one another, such as in case of micro-hazel plant mutualism. Under selection pressure, the mutualistic relationship is favoured till it becomes obligate symbiotic mutualism, that is, until the two interacting species become completely dependent on each other. At the final phase, under extreme selection pressure, the two interacting organisms start behaving as one individual, such as lichens. The mutualistic relationship initiates with exploitation, whether it's facultative or obligatory or non-symbiotic interaction between species. Insects, frugivores or birds came to the plant to consume the nectar, pollen or fruits, and meanwhile accidentally carried the seeds or pollen away from parent plants. These parent plants have more fit and adapted and ultimately exploit these occasionally visiting organisms as a seed and pollen dispersing mediators. This biological evolution of mutualistic association occur in an indirect manner. The insects or flies or other organisms involved in pollination do not deliberately help the plant in completing its life cycle, but came to take nectar or collect pollen. Similarly, frugivores, fruit-eating organisms, do not deliberately help in seed dispersal, but came to eat fruits of plants. Mutualism do not begin as one-to-one interaction. Several different kind of insects, birds and mammals attack the plants. These organisms are not specialized except in some cases for one plant. Thus, array of these animals, different taxa, encounter with various groups of plants which differ locally. These interactions resulted into diffuse co-evolution. Various taxa of animals with similar type of eating habits called as guild evolved the potential of exploiting a range of plant species. The result was novel ecological relationships showing diffuse co-evolution rather than paired co-evolution. Diffuse co-evolution mutualism. The diffuse co-evolution was favored by number of concentrants such as multiple relationships, asymmetrical evolution, etc. For example, many pollinators visited plants for pollen, but among them, only one or two species can serve best for flowers. Seasonally, the frugivores may consume variety of different fruits, but only one type of frugivore can most efficiently disperse the seeds of a particular plant. Thus, it is not impossible that one seed disperser or pollinators and just one plant will undergo close evolution. Additionally, asymmetrical evolution is another type of concentrant that causes diffuse co-evolution. In 1985, Herrera suggested that the woody plants are very ancient and evolution in them occurs at a slower rate than any of their seeds, disperser or pollinators. Furthermore, the other concentrants that prevented the tight co-evolution are seasonal changes in animal distribution and abundance. Variation in the abundance and distribution of animals and plants and seasonal differences in fruiting and flowering. Evolutionary relationships. It's a popular concept that foresty leads to the evolution of symbiotic commensalism, which in turn leads to the evolution of parasitism. Foresty, commensalism, parasitism. These evolutionary processes are still occurring in nature. However, there is evidence that at the beginning of the evolutionary pathways, commensalism exclusively does not lead to the evolution of all parasitic relationships. Although at one time it was believed that parasitism is a highly primitive type of association, is a popular one. But presently this concept is no longer accepted due to the reasons discussed afterwards. Based on the concept that host has a potential of recognizing self molecules from the non-self molecules of foreignness of an organism or parasite. The non-self recognition of foreign entity causes a host immune response against that foreign molecule, which is more served when relationship between host and parasite is relatively new. Based on this concept, we assume that if we examine among a large number of host species, in nature they are closely related to an array of parasites, particular tissue parasite, then the severest host tissue reaction is evident in those hosts which have relatively new acquired parasites. Moreover, experiments were performed to test this hypothesis. A number of instances where the parasite which is normally found in the host were experimentally introduced into host tissues resulted into less severe host tissue reactions. Thus, these experiments included that the new host tissue reaction elicited by parasitism present the initial stages of heterospecific host-parasitic relationship. At the progressive stages, spontaneous mutations causes changes that accumulate in time in the parasite which later become less foreign to host and has evolved towards commensalism. Nowadays, availability of experimental evidences suggested that pathogenicity of parasites is not necessarily dependent in the relatively new relationships with hosts. For example, in case of Plasmodium, malaria-causing protozoa, when introduced into a range of new hosts, it causes moderate malaria in some while, death in others, and in some host remains asymptomatic. Thus, these differences in the response of new hosts against Plasmodium pathogenicity lead to the conclusion that not all new hosts exhibit drastic reaction which results into diseases.
So student, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. Species not only interacts with their own types but with other species from different population also. The type of interaction is neutral, where two interacting species do not affect population growth and designated as 0-0. When both the association population are benefited, the type of interaction is called mutualism and designated as positive-positive. However, when only one type of population is benefited, forming a one-sided relationship where the interaction is neither harmed nor benefited, this type of interaction is called commensalism and designated as positive-zero. On the other hand, the other type of one-sided relationship is called as emmensalism, where one population is neither harmed nor benefited, but other population is negatively affected and designated as negative zero types. Emmensalism is a nebulous relationship which involves chemical interactions such as allopathy, effect in plants and antibiosis. Other type of interaction where one population is positively affected at the expense of another population is called as predation. Predation is designated as positive negative. Predation is possible in form of herbivory, cannibalism, parasitoidism. Finally, the type of interaction where both the interacting populations are being negatively affected are called as competition, which can be intra or interspecific competition and designated as negative-negative. Parasitism is a type of predation in which an organism called as parasite acts as predator, lives on or inside the host organism prey. It may not kill the host organism directly, but the host organism may die due to the negative effects of parasitism. A parasite receives nourishment and or shelter from the host. It is a type of non-mutualistic and negative relationship between parasite and host organism. The association can be temporary or permanent, resulting into complex interaction. Endoparasites are the parasites that live inside the body or the host, whereas those parasites that superficially attach themselves to the outer surface of host body are called as ectoparasites. Parasites which are intermediate to both endo and ectoparasite are called mesoparasites. Microparasites are small sized, rapidly multiplying, short generation time parasites, whereas macroparasites are the relatively large in size and have longer generation time. Facultative parasites, that are those parasites which are not necessarily leave the parasitic life, but under the certain circumstances are capable of adapting to parasite host relationship. Obligatory parasites are part-time or temporary parasites which completely or partially depended on the host organism to complete their life cycles. Evolution is the underlying causes of occurrence of this immense diversity in parasites. There is no obvious answer to the question of
when and where that these parasites arise from. All agreed to the assumption that parasites have evolved from the free living ancestors. The origin of parasitism, especially endoparasites, are postulated as accidental introduction of free living forms into the hosts. The host provides new environment conditions to the free living forms, and spontaneous mutations in these forms under the selection pressure resulted into the selection of only those mutants which have more profitable mutations that are necessary to sustain them in the new environment. There are three generalizations that are suggested to be responsible for the evolution of parasitism and parasites. Based on the result of theoretical speculation, Fahrenholz hypothesis, Sejert's hypothesis, Eckler's hypothesis, Penicillium, a bread mold, is the best example of emmensalism that produces bacteria killing chemical compound called penicillin antibiotics. Elephants, cattle, etc. trample the green grasses while searching for food or water resources. The cattle or elephant is unaffected, but the grasses is damaged. In plant, Juglanus nigra, the black walnut tree, is a good example for emmensalism. Allopathy is a form of interference competition among plant. For intents, the world, the most widely distributed vascular plant called Pteridium aquilinium release phytotoxins that gets concentrated in the soil upper surface. Many plants secrete toxic chemicals that are harmful to animals, such as algae blooms with red, blue and green algae release metabolites toxic to fish. It's an example of a specific type of emmensalism called antibiosis. It's a reciprocal association between two different species that positively affect both the interacting species. For example, mutualism between flowering plants and their pollinators, such as yucca moth, yucca plant and male eulocyne on orchids. Ecologists postulated that commensal relationships, parasite-host relationship or predator-prey interactions lead to evolution of mutualism. In the beginning of the interacting partners enhances the stability of available resources levels for the other partner. In time, the benefit gained in form of energy are ensured to the other partner, and probably its activities contribute to the fitness of first partner. For instance, assume that the host plant manifests the host parasitic relationship for its benefit. However, it has tolerance for the parasitic infections, indicating that the host deliberately allowed the parasite to infect itself. In time, the interacting organism exploit one another, such as in case of microhazel plant mutualism. Under selection pressure, the mutualistic relationship is favored till it's become obligate symbiotic mutualism, that is, until the two interacting species become completely dependent on each other. At the final phase, under extreme selection pressure, the two interacting organisms start behaving as one individual, such as lichens. Mutualism do not begin as one-to-one interaction. These organisms are not specialized except in some cases for one plant. Thus, array of these animals different taxa encounter with various groups of plants with different locality. These interaction resulted into diffuse co-evolution. It's a popular concept that Foresi leads to the evolution of symbiotic commensalism, which in turn lead to the evolution of parasitism. Thank you.